page two of your bulletin are the words to this song.
Into this time, let us let go of what is bothering us and ask God to come and enter into this place. Heavenly Father, we look to you. We ask for your face to shine bright among us. Lord, may our hearts, may our minds, may our ears, may our eyes, may our mouths be tuned to worship you today. Lord, it does not matter what we come into this place with. We hand it to you freely right now. May your Holy Spirit descend upon this place and teach us how to worship you with all fullness and freedom. May your grace, may your mercy, may your love, may your truth shine down upon us. We praise your holy name today. We seek your holy face today. We worship you today, for this is your day, the day that you have made. Put the joy in our heart that we may rejoice more fully and more truly. For we praise you and we pray to you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Well, welcome to another Sunday here at Horizon. We are pleased to have you with us. And if you are, either whether you are here or whether you are watching us on Zoom or on YouTube, we just are overjoyed to have you with us. So every Sunday at 10 a.m., we are here and we are worshiping God. So I would love it if you would remember that. And also invite someone and bring someone with you that we may all worship together. Another announcement is that we need lots of volunteers. We need people to help us with this worship. I had an interesting dream last night. It was, we were all here, and then all of a sudden there was a flood of people that came in. And there were people that came, and there were people that said, hey, there were people in choir robes that were just joining in, and then they just started singing in the back. So, you know, I don't know exactly what that means. I don't have my Joseph here with me to help me interpret my dreams, but I honestly see that as God's trying to tell us and teach us and show us there are going to be people that are going to be rising up and going to be, maybe we build up a choir or a band that we are ready to worship God and ready to be able to spread God's word throughout this entire valley. Not just among us, but into this entire valley.
Amen.
So let us just prepare that. And so if God puts something on your heart, don't hold back. Say, yes, Lord, use me. Another thing, we would love it if you would join us for Bible study on Wednesdays. We've been making our way through Acts, and it's really interesting because we are here, we're preaching out of Acts. We're at the end of Acts. We're talking about Paul's imprisonment and how he is dealing with authorities. And we're talking in Bible study about Stephen dealing with very similar circumstances. So there are parallels that we are seeing between what Stephen was dealing with and what Paul is dealing with what we're talking about. So it's just they're interesting things that, you know, if we weren't studying these two things in parallel, it'd be, you may not make that connection. But if you join us for our Bible study, you see these interesting connections that get made throughout Acts. And there's a way that God is speaking to us and teaching us uniquely about what God is doing in the church and what he's calling us to do and to be. The other thing is, I want to draw your attention to the bulletin. Leland has been making some additions. Not only is there the worship songs that are there, but also, you know, maybe we get tripped up here from time to time. And one of Mosian's great suggestions is that we put in, whenever there's a call and response or some liturgical thing that we do, hey, just put it in here. And Leland has done a great job here of putting some of those things in here, as well as putting the Lord's Prayer. He got a little Catholic with us and called it our Father Prayer, but that's okay. We call it the Lord's Prayer, but it's the same thing. So when we get to that part of our service, you know, sometimes we get tripped up and forget the words. They're right here for us. So whatever there is, if you guys have any suggestions, Leland has been great at, like, taking those suggestions and adding them to this. So it's all right here, as well as all of the basic information. Hey, you need to share something with somebody. This is a great tool that we have. The back of your bulletin has all the church website, the Zoom links, all of that. It's right here for you. So if you have someone that you want to share that with, or if you need to remember yourself, it's all right there. So once again, we want to thank Leland for putting that together every week. So we are blessed. So with that.
And I would say, if you think of something after the service and you already went home, you can call me or leave me a message on my phone number that is on page 6, I believe, in the bulletin. Or you can leave a message with the pastor. His phone number's in there too. So.
And with that,
give us a call.
And with that, I invite you, if you are able, to please stand as we sing God's praises.
I was reminded of Psalm 51, verse 10. Create me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. So let's sing Refiner's Fire.
Okay.
excellent. Song is going to be a wonderful hymn when I survey the wondrous cross. And this is the gospel story about how Jesus Christ was sent from heaven by God Almighty, and he paid the price for our sins on that cross. And he was raised from the dead, and he lived forever. And since he is raised from the dead, we can be raised from the dead if we believe on him. So let's sing, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
every single person in this sanctuary right now possesses amazing and wondrous power. There's not one person in here right now that doesn't possess a power that is unique. There is not one person in here that does not possess power to change the world. Every single one of you, not by anything that you have done, but by who God has made you to be, you possess a power that this world cannot resist. God calls us to use the powers that we have been given to do great things in our world. Some of us use those powers to do mighty things. God has given great minds to people. Minds so great that they have taken us into space. Minds so great that they have created things that so many feel they cannot live without. God has created such people with such creativity that have created so much beauty that we stand in awe of them. However, the power that God has put in you is even greater than that. The things that God has given you power to do is far greater than the painting of the Sistine Chapel. It's even greater than building rockets that take us into space. It's even greater than building an iPhone. For God has given you a unique purpose, and that is to change the world that we are in. God used Paul. As we have talked about in Acts, and God used Paul to go to really diverse places and be able to share the gospel and spread the gospel message that was just concentrated in Jerusalem and spread throughout the Greek world, spread throughout Rome, in a way that God uniquely prepared him to do. Remember, Paul, the persecutor of the church, ends up being the person that God uses to spread the word to the Gentiles. And it was those very words that we left last week with that rose up such anger in the people, in the Jews. They didn't want to hear that God had given his message not only to Jews, but to Gentiles as well. They took this message as defilement. But God knew that Paul, at this point, from this point forward in the book, Paul will never see freedom again. Paul will be imprisoned in one form or another for the rest of Acts. And yet, God still gave him power to do something unique. Not something he paid for, but something that he was born with. And God has put something in you from birth to be able to share the gospel in only a way that you could. So let us, as we turn to scriptures, let us ask God to remind us and show us and open our hearts and minds to what that power is that we have. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we look unto you. We ask for your grace. We ask for your mercy. We ask for your love. We ask for you to show us and open our minds. Open our eyes, open our hearts, open our ears to hear. May we see what power you have put in us. And may we use that power to spread your gospel in a way that only we could. For great is your name above all names. Holy God, we ask you to come and enter in. Open up these scriptures to us that we may see you fresh, that we may see you unique, that we may see you that may stir something in us, that we may go out and spread your gospel. For we pray all of this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I now ask you to open your Bibles to Acts 22, starting in verse 22. Up to this word, remember, this is up to the word where Paul is saying that God sent him to the Gentiles. They listened to him. Then they raised their voices and said, "Away with such a fellow from the earth, for he should not be allowed to live." And as they were shouting and throwing off their cloaks and flinging dust into the air, the tribune ordered him to be brought into the barracks, saying that he should be examined by flogging. To find out why they were shouting against him like this. But when they had stretched him out for the whips, Paul said to the centurion who was standing by, "Is it lawful for you to flog a man who is a Roman citizen and uncondemned?" When the centurion heard this, he went for the tribune and said to him, "What are you about to do? For this man is a Roman citizen." So the tribune came to him and said, "Tell me, are you a Roman citizen?" And he said, "Yes." The tribune answered, "I bought this citizenship for a large sum." And Paul said, "But I am a citizen by birth." So those who were about to examine him withdrew from him immediately. And the tribune also was afraid, for he realized that Paul was a Roman citizen and that he had bound him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Paul's words, they were different. Paul's words were something that rose up anger. Because no longer could the Jews claim that God was only for them and not for anyone else. For God's gospel message wasn't just for the Jews, but it was for the whole world. God used the Jewish people to save the world. For from the Jewish people, God sent Jesus, and Jesus went to the cross. This was something unique. It was really hard to hear. Because so many of them had been raised in such a way that thought that they were unique and that God's salvation was for them uniquely. But they misunderstood their uniqueness. And let us not understand our uniqueness. Our uniqueness isn't the fact that God is for us and us alone. But our uniqueness is so that God can use us
and use our uniqueness, our unique power, to share a gospel message that is for the world. Let us hear the words of John 3:16. For God so loved. Here's my call and response. I'm sorry. For God so loved
the world that he gave his only begotten Son.
Yeah. It's the important part here is that God didn't just love. For God so loved Horizon Community Church. For God so loved the corner of R and 20th. No, God loved the world, Jews and Gentiles alike. Everyone has access to Jesus. And Paul knew this and uniquely was able to say, you know, I was a Jew. And so I understand why Jews thought that this was only for them. I thought that myself until I encountered Jesus himself. We talked about that last week. Paul's recounting his story about how Jesus reached out and grabbed him, in a manner of speaking. He said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? Paul, not understanding his uniqueness, said, who are you, Lord? And so when Paul went from being the persecutor to being the great evangelist, Paul understood from a unique perspective how to preach a gospel message. And then when God sent Paul out into the world to speak to the Gentiles as well, God gave him a unique perspective. For Paul wasn't just another guy, but Paul was a Roman citizen. This gave Paul a unique power. In what arenas has God put you that you will be able to preach the gospel? In what arenas has God put you? What areas of life has God put you so that you will be able to uniquely preach the gospel? What unique powers has God given you? The temptation to say is, I'm not powerful. I'm weak. I'm slow. I'm not smart enough. I'm not a good enough speaker. We like to focus on what we aren't. God wants us to focus on who we are. Yeah, I'm not Leland. I could focus on how I can't play guitar, so therefore, I can't lead a church. That's clearly not true. I mean, it doesn't say anything about Paul. Maybe he was a great guitar player, but scriptures don't say anything about that.
Would have been a loop, I think, in those times.
But it does talk about what Paul was. And Paul didn't always, like, he didn't flaunt it. He didn't go around saying, I'm a Roman, I'm a Roman, I'm a Roman. No, Paul waited until it was most beneficial
to reveal his Roman citizenship. Why? Who knows? But probably because this was the moment where the Holy Spirit was able to use him in a most unique way. For as a Roman citizen, he couldn't just, if he were to be lying about his citizenship, that was the death penalty. And so probably people didn't just throw that around loosely. And that's why he said, you know, I paid a lot. The tribune was there. He's like, I paid a lot for my citizenship. I had to do this, this, and this. Paul's like, I was born with it. Many of us in this room were born with a power, born with an ability, born with the privilege to be able to speak about who God is in our life that will touch somebody's life in a way that only God has, the things that God has put in us, would be able to communicate God's love perfectly for someone. We talked about in Bible study, you know, there are people that have been through certain things that will be able to speak to people who've gone through who are currently in certain circumstances. That will be able to speak truth, a truth that is unique to them, but a truth that is also universal, that God loves you. Maybe there's a certain sin that we have dealt with that we are able to uniquely help somebody who is trapped in that sin. Maybe there's a lifestyle that someone's in that we have the unique ability to speak into that lifestyle. Or maybe it's something as simple as you know a specific language that is able to uniquely address somebody who doesn't speak another language. But that language isn't just English, Spanish, French. That language is who you are. You know how to speak in such a way to be able to communicate to somebody what God's love is really about. Now, the way we communicate is going to anger some. And there's nothing that we can do to prevent somebody from getting angry about something that we say or do. But in the midst of this, Paul doesn't match that anger for anger. Instead, Paul sees an opportunity. Just like last week, we talked about how Paul had the opportunity to speak God's truth because he was able to speak Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic. On this, Paul knows that he's able to speak uniquely to the centurion,
to the tribune, to those who are imprisoning him, because he's a Roman citizen. And they know what that's about. And they instantly go from being, we have to do this to be able to understand that. They're about to stretch him out and whip him. And tear his flesh, trying to get information out of him, to torture him, to get information out of him, to being one, concerned about themselves, because they know they can't just do this to a Roman citizen. But two, they now have ears open to be able to hear what Paul is going to say. They know they now have to listen to him. He has a voice. And that voice is power. Where do you have power to speak? With whom do you have the power to speak and be heard? And are you willing to share the gospel in those instances? Too often we kind of keep some things silent because, oh, well, they're a Christian. I don't need to talk to them. But God needs us to be building up the kingdom. And so we need to be constantly sharing the gospel, whether you think someone's a Christian or not. Share the gospel. No matter how well you know someone, share the gospel. That includes your own households. That includes your own friend groups. A couple weeks ago, we talked about gossip. Our friend groups aren't about sharing gossip. Our friend groups are about sharing gospel. So brothers and sisters, God is calling us to use the power that we have. And that is the connections that we have to people. The connections we have to government. The connections we have in our community. The connections we have in our companies. In our schools. In our social groups. There is power that we have been given, whether we earned it or not. And we're called to use that to share the gospel, to build up God's kingdom, to glorify God. For the Westminster Catechism, one of the main catechisms that the Presbyterian Church is at, looks to. The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we look unto You. May You imbue us with power that we are able to share Your gospel with everyone. That we may be able to spread Your gospel everywhere. That we may embody Your gospel, that Your kingdom grows and that You are glorified. We look unto You, O Lord. Remind us of who we are and not who we aren't. And build up our minds that we may glorify You and enjoy You forever. For we pray all of this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Now please stand for the doxology and the glory of Bhakti.
Kingdom through the gifts that we grant unto you. Lord, may your grace, may your mercy, may your love, may your truth, may everything emerge from you. And may your kingdom, may your gospel message, may it spread throughout the Antelope Valley and into the world. Lord, use this, that your name may be glorified by all. For we pray all of this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Let us go in peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.